I'm so happy. I'm happy with the people around me. I feel more moral than I was when I was 25. I feel less confused about how to be. And all of that is just because of taking in art and making it. And so I just, you know, I don't think that I just think it becomes, the faith that I had in it is proved to have been the right faith.
The library was my space, and there was just so much.
To the Harbor Grace excursion with the boys to have a time.
This is my first in-person event. So this is what the other side of Zoom must look like. I want to start talking to you by bringing up how I read. When I read a book, I like to pay attention to what it wants to be up to and what it achieves on its own terms. I didn't go into pure color looking for what I wished for it to be. I'm present with the work in front of me. What struck me was the beauty of pure color's assemblage. First, with the green on the front, I read its shape and size, how it took up space on the cover, and then how every time I encountered this color inside the book, that color felt loud and incredibly visible. Can you tell us a little bit about your choosing or what the process you had in assembling the front cover?
Yeah, of course. So when the Na Kim is the woman who designed the cover, she's a brilliant cover designer, and she sent me this, except instead of the green, it was sort of like it was just a perfect circle, a black circle. And I thought, I looked at the cover and I thought that the circle was too perfect, because the book had, to me, has a more, is more about a sort of offness and not a perfect world, something kind of in progress. And so, but I really loved the font, and I had stayed at my friend Leanne Chapton's apartment in New York when I was visiting, while I was writing the book, and she had this painting on her wall. Ellsworth Kelly is the artist. It's called Green. And I remember I was sleeping on her couch, and it was there on the wall, and just thinking, oh, that could, I wonder if that could be a cover for my book one day. Though the book had not yet been completed, so that's a very hopeful thought. I'm always looking for covers when I'm writing, just so I can visualize the fact that one day it'll be done. I'm always like making little mock-ups on my computer, like with whatever the working title is and my name, and then like a little picture, and just like visualize it being done. And so when Na sent me that cover, thank you so much, I thought, can we try the Ellsworth Kelly? And so we tried this, and we tried a bunch of other things, some paintings from my friend Margot, and it was just like about a month and a half of looking at different things. And then, you know, this is gold, and I think I'd liked it. It was black and black, and I was teaching a creative writing course during the time that I was designing, we were designing the cover of the book, and I had this exercise called the missing book, which is something I really like to do, which is I just tell the students, like, write down a description of the book that is missing from your shelf. And it can be like the feelings that it evokes in you, or like what it's about, or what it looks like, just like what's the missing book, you know? And it's amazing, like, what comes out. Anyways, this one girl had written her missing book, and I read it and I was like, you just described pure color. And she said that the cover was gold and green. And I thought, oh, that's the problem with this cover. There's no gold on it. Mm-hmm. So her, I was just like, oh, I called Na and I was like, we need gold on the cover. And then she made the name gold and then it became the perfect cover.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that you would be drawn to painting, because when I looked at your sentences and especially at your words, you form or use words the way that a painter might use color. Like, for example, whenever we encounter a painting of, say, the sky or a body of water, it's usually in the color blue. But an artist that surprises us might paint it pink or yellow. I'm speaking in particular about this word that I've seen a few critics balk at, or bring up a lot, or pay quite a bit of attention to. And that word is ejaculate.
I knew you were gonna say that.
you describe this loving moment when Mira and her father are united in the body of a leaf. I understand the association and the encounter that we usually have with a word in a sentence. But in this case, I never associated anything dirty or sexual about it. I just trusted that that's how you use the word, and it was detached from how I often see that word in a sentence. Mm-hmm. So my question is, why did you deliberately use this particular word in a way that made us detach ourselves from its normal associations?
The context is that when Mira's father dies, I say that she's holding him as he dies, and I say that the universe ejaculated his spirit into her body. And yes, a lot of the critics like took it to be very sexual, but to me, that word was just so useful because I wanted it to seem like, well, I don't really know, but everyone knows what that means. It's like this sudden, forceful, deliverance, you know, of something. And like, that's how I saw it. That was how the spirit came out and went into her. And I think, and that's why I use that word. There's no other word to describe something that, with that particular suddenness. And I guess I also liked it because like ejaculation delivers life, like it delivers, and it's the beginning of life, and this is the end of life, and it delivered a new life into Mira, so it just seemed like the right word.
I think it's the perfect word.
Thank you.
That's why I brought it up. And the way that you describe the two people in the book, the way that you describe their desire, the way that you use these two particular words, open and wide, in several sentences, you cluster them together and you form this single moment. Because I'm so concerned, or I pay so much attention to how you're using the texture of these words, I'm always wondering, on the other side of it, what is editing like for you?
So I guess I always keep the first draft of something, and then I edit in the sense of like I'm always trying to make the sentence have a certain rhythm, and to have a certain. I like repetition, as we were talking about in the green room. Like I like that kind of trance-like feeling. I somebody asked me the other day if I read stuff out loud, but I don't. I hear it out loud in my head. And so I think I edit so the way that somebody, I think I edit it like it's music. Mm-hmm. Like it's really for the sound and the rhythm. And then I always want to make sure that I don't get too, you know, so then when I have something that I feel good about, I look back at the original writing of it and I compare them, because I always am suspicious of editing at the same time that I need it. I'm suspicious of the way that it can leach out something, that original, raw, even imperfect. When you get it down for the first time, it has something that a later version just doesn't have. Mm-hmm. And so often I'll bring back sentences from the original into the edited to sort of, yeah, so I'm always trying, it's this balance between wanting to keep the rawness and wanting to have a rhythm. Mm-hmm. So it's always like, okay, how can I keep that rawness of the first draft and the rhythm of what I'm going for when I'm editing?
Do you ever throw anything away?
Yeah, lots.
I'm thinking in particular about this 10-part piece I read in the New York Times where you were keeping, or you put sentences into an Excel sheet from your diary over the years. So I'm wondering, when it comes to writing, how do you know what to keep?
I keep the stuff that I like rereading. Mm. And if I don't like rereading it, I'll get rid of it.
Mm. I couldn't help but be haunted by the draft before Pure Color became a book. Yeah, I was lucky enough to see a manuscript of it.
And you think it was better than the one that was published?
Oh, no, no.
I'm just like, oh,
no. But I wanted to know, for you, is the first draft your favorite draft to write?
No. Now I'm like reinterpreting all your questions. Like, how do you edit and how do you know what to throw out? I mean, it's hard because the first time somebody reads something, it's going to be the best. Mm-hmm. So I feel like, that's me talking to myself about your question. What was your question?
About what your favorite draft is.
Oh, well, there was just so many drafts of this book. So there was like a version that didn't even have the death of the father in it. Mm-hmm. And so that was my first draft. And the Mira was a princess. Mm-hmm. And she went to the house of this prince and was trying to decide which of the two male critics there to have sex with. I mean, that was the first draft. It wasn't my favorite. It was pretty stupid. I was trying to do this thing of like writing 10,000 words a week. I think I'm trying to remember which classic writer I had just read that summer, who wrote 10,000 words a week, or a day, or something crazy like that. And I was like, I'm going to use that process. I can't remember the writer now, and I just wrote junk, you know. And it sort of taught me something about like, don't try to imitate somebody else's process, because you're going to end up writing about, well, for me, just this dumb narrative. But no, I think this is my favorite version of it.
I thought about the death of the father a lot. I always want to know in practical terms what happens after someone dies. Can you talk to them? And what I've experienced about the language of grief and passing is that people always tell you they're in a better place, or they just say that, or they create, tell you of a world like heaven where somebody goes to. And to be honest, well, you know, my grandmother is a lovely lady, but I'm not quite sure she went to heaven. And but I don't want to imagine her in hell or in a horrible place. And when I read this book, I loved that the idea of what happens, what occurs between two people is so possible or is so achievable, and it's right here in the world. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't, would you say that you, what prompted this imagining or of this, of what happens when someone dies?
It was just what I experienced. Mm. And also, I mean, I think it makes a difference what myths you grow up with. So I didn't grow up with, I'm not Christian, so I think, you know, in Judaism there isn't hell. Mm-hmm. And there isn't really heaven. There's a kind of agnosticism about what happens after. There's like, well, we don't really know. So I don't think I ever had that picture in my head that somebody would go to heaven or hell. That doesn't make any sense to me. And I grew up, you know, Jewish, but kind of, again, in a very atheistic home. And what was always told to me is that when somebody dies, that's it. You know, there's just no after. And what I experienced when my father died was something much more mystical than that. It didn't feel like, well, now he's just dead, you know? I did have a sense of like spirit or soul or whatever. But I don't think there's anywhere else to go but here. You know, and the reason, you know, they go into a leaf, like that just seems right. I mean, especially when a person dies and they go into the ground and then they're eaten up by the bugs and then they become a tree. Like, it just makes sense that we all stay here in some way. I don't see where else there is to go.
I like what you've said there. It's so optimistic. You're very open about your life. The material you work with is not just true and real, but it has the texture of what feels true and real. And you make artistic choices with what is true and real. But yet, to me, I've known you and your writing for almost 25 years, and yet you remain mysterious and deeply private to me, and I think to a lot of people. How do you achieve this balance between like being so open and working with what's true and real, but also managing to not let everybody in? Or everything in?
I mean, I think that if we'd hung out more, you'd not have that question. I mean, I don't think I'm interested in myself in the sense of, like, I don't think I have an interesting life or anything like that. I just think that my life is like everyone else's life, and my life is an example of a life, and it's the life I'm closest to, and so it's the one that I can look at the most clearly and gain the most information from. So I'm never trying to tell anyone about me. I'm just trying to understand what a life is. Mm-hmm. And so I don't think that I don't have anything to say about myself. It's just, you know, I was thinking the other day about romantic relationships and how when a person breaks up, suddenly they tell you, oh yeah, we had these terrible fights, and you get this, the true picture. And when they're in the relationship, you think you're getting the true picture of their relationship, but you're not. You're just getting this tiny little, what they can bear to tell you about it. Because if they tell you everything, then you're gonna say, like, get out. And then, and I think almost everybody's in this kind of situation of like really filtering. And so I can't write about the world based on the stories I've heard from other people, because everyone's always filtering. So that's why I have to look at my own life. But I don't think, yeah.
Sheila, I think that you have such a lovely heart. What's always been so clear to me reading your books is your joy and faith and love of art. And I'm just wondering, over the course of 10 books, how does one hold on to this lovely heart?
That's like the nicest thing anyone's ever said to me. I don't wanna like cry or something. I just believe in it more and more, you know, because mm-hmm. it puts you into contact with people in a very special way. And it's made for me a really beautiful life. And so I think at the beginning you have this faith, you're like, okay, I'm gonna make art, but it's just a guess that that's going to be good for you or your world. You just don't know. And then I have found, I mean, I'm 45 now, like, I'm so happy. I'm happy with the people around me. I feel more moral than I was when I was 25. I feel less confused about how to be. And all of that is just because of taking in art and making mm-hmm. it. And so I just, you know, I don't think that I just think it becomes, the faith that I had in it is proved to have been the right faith for me.
And also how lucky for us. what interests you now?
Well, I've been sick all week, so the Amber Heard Johnny Depp trials is the only thing that interests me. I wish I had a better answer. It's like exactly the level that I'm at. I can't watch it though, because he just talks so slowly. So I don't have the patience for him to finish his sentences. So I've been reading the articles and looking at her, pictures of her. She's so beautiful. But it changes it when you hear her yelling.
Like what she has said to have done on the bed?
They've both been not very nice to each other.
I feel like you always know how to find the interesting. Like, if I gave you a piece of wood right now, you would know what to do with it.
Wood?
And I'm wondering, how do you... I mean, this is so hard to teach. So, for example, like, whenever we encounter students of writing, it's so hard to teach them to care over and over about each draft, each word, what something looks like on the page, how something comes together, the assemblage of a book. So if you might offer that way of thinking about how to care about or how to find the interesting, even with, for someone who has had books, it's not like I know everything or I know how to get there. I too need advice. So I'm just wondering how you would say what we do to care or to find that the interesting.
I mean, I asked Souvankham to interview me because she's one of my favorite writers. And it's been the case, like you said, for like 25 years when I first heard you give a poetry reading. It's so funny to hear that question come from you, because it doesn't seem like a question that you need to ask. Your work is so careful and so sort of exactly as quiet and loud and big and small as it needs to be. Like, you've always found the perfect shape, and it seems to me.
I'm so afraid of losing that or not remembering.
Why would you lose it?
Because I have this desire to like throw everything that other people want from me or think that I'm good at away. I don't know why.
maybe you should. I mean, if that's your desire.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think, so, okay, so I guess, like, yeah, that just, like, that's the answer that I was going to give originally, and, like, it's just proves to be true. Like, you just have to do what, like, just if it's boring, don't do it. So if you're, like, now at this stage, like, writing stuff, if everyone's like, oh, your work is so fine and so precise and, you know, and so sensitive, and you're like, you want to throw all that away, that's just, like, that seems like a really fun thing to do. Mm-hmm. Really exciting thing to do. I just never do anything with writing that doesn't seem, that isn't exciting to me in that moment. I don't have like a plan or a process or a procedure. I don't work every day. I don't make myself do anything mm-hmm. I don't make myself follow through on things. Mm-hmm. Like, you have to use who you are, and I have very bad follow through and discipline. Like, I always mm-hmm. like when I was a kid, I quit ballet, I quit piano, I quit everything. And so, but like, so I've just like let myself be a quitter. And if you like, you let your, if you're a quitter and you let yourself be a quitter, then the few things that stay that are really the things you don't want to quit and the things that you're genuinely interested in. So you can use your bad traits and make them into good traits, because as a result of like letting myself be a quitter, I've only ever worked on the things that are the most meaningful to me. But if I had tried to force myself not to be a quitter, I would have written a lot of things that would have been a slog for me to write.
Mm-hmm. You've said in interviews before, like, what would happen if you wrote something that wasn't beautiful, that didn't entertain, that didn't make people feel good? And I loved that freedom that you gave yourself. Are there things that you feel narrowed or that you feel you can't do?
I mean, there's things that I don't want to do and that I know I'm not good at. Mm-hmm. So, you know, writing screenplays or whatever, I don't want to, and I know I'm not good at it. So those are things I don't do. But things that I don't let myself, you said?
Yeah. Why don't you want to write a screenplay? What is it about that form of working that...
I just don't think I love film enough or love TV enough to be the right person to do it. Like, I just don't care enough. But like, okay, so I don't, so I think that I don't think so. But you know, I haven't started writing another book yet, so I don't have like perfect answers to these questions. Mm-hmm. Like, I finished this in the summer and I haven't started a new book yet. Mm-hmm. So.
Does that prospect excite you, or?
I just feel like it's like waiting for a bus or something. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm like, I feel kind of impatient and a little like antsy, and I'm like, you know, I'm like, you're constantly looking, like, is it coming? And then you gotta tell yourself, just stop looking, like, do something else, like, stop looking. Like, constantly stepping out into the road, like, I just wish I could preoccupy myself in the meantime.
Well, you do have another book coming out, right? Like,
the children's book. Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's called A Garden of Creatures, and it's a picture book with illustrations by Esme Shapiro. And my boyfriend pointed out, he's like, you wrote two children's books about death. And I hadn't meant to, but yes, it's also about death, like the first one. But I wrote it when I was writing this book. Like, I mean, my father died, and that was all in my head. So I wrote that book. Again, like, I wasn't trying to write a children's book. I was literally waiting for a bus and going to clean out my father's house. There's so much you have to do like that after somebody dies. It's incredible, the bureaucracy and the tasks and the errands. I almost feel like that stuff all exists in order to keep you in the world. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so frustrating, but you're like, well, at least you have, anyways. And I wrote this story on my phone, it just came to me, and then I sent it to Esme, who I sort of vaguely knew. She makes beautiful children's books, and I said, do you think this is good? And she said, you know, grandfather had just died, and she said she loved it and she wanted to make into a children's book. So I feel like often these things just kind of like they just, they come or they don't come. Like there's really nothing to, I don't know.
Do you think children are your ideal reader? The way in which they take in the world and the kinds of questions that they ask, that as adults we're a little ashamed of asking or forget to form in our mind, or that we can?
I don't think so, because they don't need art somehow the way adults do. They
find everything interesting.
Yeah, exactly. They make everything interesting. I think like teenagers or people in their early 20s maybe. Mm-hmm. I was thinking the other day, like I would like to be a writer who those people especially like, because that's an age where, that to me is when books were most important for me. And I think the people that 20-year-olds like, I think the writers that 20-year-olds like are a little dumber. Like, and I mean that like in a positive way, like Kurt Vonnegut or, there's just something a little more, not dumber, but like a little bit more naive. Mm-hmm. There's something a bit more, like you're saying, open. Henry Miller, you know, these writers that kind of, they're still teenagers a bit themselves. Mm. I think that's a nice kind of writer to be. Mm. And those are nice people, and that's a nice age to, like, for. And then there's some of those writers when you read when you're, like, 20 and you can't read them later in life because you've kind of moved beyond them. I don't mind if that's the case for me.
Mm. Well, I still like the books that I read when I was younger, like The Velveteen Rabbit.
I just recently reread Crime and Punishment, which I read first when I was 18. And I think I had like a crush on Raskolnikov when I was 18 and I read it. And now I'm just like, oh, that poor young boy. You know, I just want to like take care of him. It's so interesting to read a book 20 years apart or 30 or whatever years apart.
Well, I was wondering, since, you know, there are other people in the room, we might open it up to other people in the room to maybe ask you some questions. But before we move to them, I wanted to read a sentence that that I love encountering in the book Pure Color. Making an artwork is like a signal or flare calling out, beckoning its kind to come near. Sheila, you've been so generous and open this evening, and I'm so grateful to be here on stage with you and near. And now it's the audience turn to be near.
Thanks, Souvankham. Thank you for all your beautiful questions.